All right, go ahead and take your Bibles out. Turn over to the book of Jude. Book of Jude. Again, I appreciate all of you who prayed for our teens up at Camp Calvary this weekend. We had a tremendous time. We are definitely tired. If I say something twice or that doesn't make sense, just smile and nod at me and we'll keep on rolling. But excited to go into the Word and in this small book of Jude. Now, the truth we're going to talk about tonight is one that I don't think is new to anyone in here that is a professing believer. In fact, I think everyone that professes a believer here should say that they are currently attempting to do this, and that is grow in your faith, right? I think we can all say, if I asked everyone to raise your hands and say, how many of you want to grow in your faith? I would assume everyone's hands would shoot right up and say, yes, I am a Christian, I'm a follower of Christ, I want to grow in my faith. And the book of Jude talks about this. And it describes it in specific terms, that of contending for the faith. Now, how many of you have, and maybe some of you are at this point are like, I don't really engage in this hobby anymore, but how many of you have had hobbies in your life, whether that be sports or, computer games maybe, or board games, or horseshoes, or mountain climbing, I don't know, something along those lines. Let me see your hand. All right, now how many of you, out of all of those things, most of them anyway, especially that have that require physical exertion in some form, how many of you, it was always easy for you to do what you like to do in that hobby? Raise your hand. Always easy. No problem at all. All right, that's interesting. See, I had, most of the ones I have, maybe this is just different for me, but for most of the hobbies that I had, whether that be sports of some kind or something in the outdoors I like to do mountain biking, obviously, that's one of them. But you can pretty much name anything outdoors, I enjoy doing it. But there has been times throughout those, I'm just going to pick sports because most of us can relate in some way to that, all right? So let's just say that we all are engaging in some type of sport here, okay? And we all love to do it, right? Now, there's a point in time when you're engaging in that sport, whether that's in practice or the game itself, where all of a sudden you maybe feel kind of like, all right, I don't want to do this anymore. Anyone, you with me with this? You know what I'm talking about? Whether it's maybe in practice and you're on the 30,000th lap, you know, and suddenly you're saying, I hate soccer right now. You following me? You know what I'm talking about? But you love playing and, you know, you continue to play. I remember as a little kid, soccer is probably my favorite sport to play growing up anyway. And I remember as a little kid playing soccer and I loved it, but there were times when I would be out on that field and I'd be ready to throw up and I would be like, what am I doing out here? I hate this. Why do I do this? Why do I try to do this? Now, if we, you know, those of you that have played sports or whatever your hobby might be, that is some type of physical exertion, you understand that, right? We can understand that sometimes what we love to do is hard to do. And what do we always say? If I'm a coach, what do I tell my guys to do? Push through it, right? Push through that. Fight through that. It'll be worth it in the end, right? Well, this is kind of a book that says similar type thing, but applying it to our spiritual life. So we're going to talk today about how do we fight, or how do we, in the terms that are used here in Jude, how do we contend for our faith? Now, to be clear, before I start, I want the goal here to be understood. Today, we're not talking about promoting a moralistic or legalistic, ritualistic style of Christian living. Anyone who has tried to fight for the faith in such a way has hopefully learned by now that that road simply does not work. It does not bring glory to God. It does not bring joy. It does not bring freedom in the Christian life, but it rather puts the Christian into the bondage of the law. So contending for the faith is not a laundry list of do's and don'ts, okay? So we'll just scratch that off right there. That's not where we're headed with this. So what is it? The question is, how then should we live as contenders for the faith? We're going to see here three specific areas that this can be accomplished here in the book of Jude. So let's take your Bibles, if you're not already there, book of Jude. I want to ask you this. How many of you have been, or perhaps are even right now, at a point where you have kind of grown frustrated? Frustrated with God, frustrated with the world, frustrated at this calling to live for Christ, and it just kind of feels impossibly hard. You're at that moment when you've just run the 30,000th lap, so to speak, and you're sitting on the field ready to throw up thinking, what am I doing here? Now, if you're not here there now, you've been there, you will be there at some point, right? We all understand what that feels like. You feel like it's impossible to live in the way that God has called you to live. What we're about to look at here in the book of Jude is God's answer to that feeling, that question. How do I live as a Christian in this world, especially in the light of my failures, especially in the light of my struggles right now, how I'm hurting right now? How do I continue to contend for the faith? And at the beginning of the book of Jude, it says there in verse 3, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly," what? "Contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints." All right, so here we have the beginning of the book, that introductory command, contend for the faith. And Jude here at the end, and we're actually going to be focusing on the last few verses of this book. I'm just trying to give some context here. And Jude at the end of this tiny book lays out three ways or three principles in which we as Christians can put this idea of contending for the faith into practice. Now we need to do a quick review of the idea of contend. Contending is what? It's fighting, right? It's fighting for something, hopefully something that you believe in. And when you're fighting for something, what does that imply? Well, it implies that you have an opponent of some kind, right? You have something that you are warring against in some way. This is the description that Jude gives of the Christian life. If you are a Christian living in this world, you are contending. You ought to be contending. You're fighting against something, right? This weekend at the retreat, thank you. This weekend at the retreat with our teens, we had the theme of out of darkness, coming out of 2 Peter. And the idea that we are a peculiar people, a chosen generation, that we're called out of darkness to live unto marvelous light, right? And so as we live in this world, we ought not be at home in this world. We're aliens, so to speak, here. And so when we're aliens in a world that does not love us, that in fact fights against us, we ought to be contending for something, right? It kind of makes sense. You ought not be just complacent in your walk. You are fighting. You are constantly fighting. It's a battle that you are fighting for your whole life as a Christian. It's not a point where you fight, 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 and then you're good. No, we continue to fight. It doesn't matter if you are 10 years old or if you're 100 years old in this room. You are fighting. You ought to be fighting. You ought to be contending for the faith. If you disagree with me, if you were to come to me right now and say, you know, actually, I don't really feel that way at all. I actually feel quite at home with the world around me. Well, you know, I would say that's a problem. Either the world isn't as bad and as wicked as the Bible says, or you are not so much a dedicated follower of Christ as you might think, if that is the case. So you know, as a Christian, you have an enemy. And hopefully now you know that this enemy that you must contend, you must fight against, is always there, is always fighting. And we know him, what? As Satan, right? Or we could say our flesh as well, that wars against us constantly. And so the question here is, how do we contend? How do you and I fight the fight that God has called us to? How do we remain faithful in our faith? So that brings us now to our three principles. So the three things we're going to see in the next few minutes here, and we'll be done, is number one, we must be alert. Number two, be mature. And number three, be encouragers. Number one, be alert. At the beginning of the book of Jude, he tells us the church, or he tells the church that he's writing to, in essence, wake up. He says, wake up, to pay attention, to contend. For what reason? Because certain people, false teachers, had what? They had crept into their midst without being noticed, without being seen, who were perverting the grace of God. And were going so far as to deny Christ. They were tainting who Christ was. He goes on to describe the problem of sin. Sin is everywhere. And up to verse 17, it all feels a bit discouraging. All right, he's speaking of all of their failures, where they have fallen short of who they are as followers of Christ. But then he gets to verse 17 and he says, "But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time who shall walk after their own ungodly lust. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit." Perhaps some of you are there right now. You see your failures, you see where you have allowed false teachers to creep into your lives, and you're simply a bit overwhelmed, you're a bit disheartened at this time. And so here in verse 17, Jude begins to encourage the church that all hope is not lost. Yes, you've been failing. Yes, you have been struggling. Yes, you have been buying into the deceitfulness of false teachers creeping in and attacking doctrine. But it's not too late. So here in verse 17, Jude begins to encourage the people, the church there, that all hope is not lost, that you can once again return to the fight. We see in verse 17 here, under things that we ought to be alert to, that it's predicted here of false teachers. If you spent any time in the New Testament, then this phrase should not be a shock to you, right? All through the New Testament, you will find predictions of false prophets rising up, desiring to pull Christians away from the faith. And it was happening back then, it is still happening now. Matthew 24:24 says, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and they shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they would deceive the very elect." Who's the elect? Us, right? We should be aware. We should be ready. Acts 20:29, "For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, and spare not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them." And then it says, "Therefore watch." Be looking, be ready, be aware. "Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears." All right. So we have here, and those are just a couple of examples of many that are predicting false teachers, false truth to come into the church. Jude is saying, be alert. Remember the predictions. And these are not predictions like, you know, the many predictions that we have today of who will win the Super Bowl. How many of you got the prediction the Super Bowl win right this year? Anybody? Nobody. Wow. I didn't either, actually. I wanted the Falcons to win, personally, but oh well. It's not like predictions of sports. It's not like predictions of the weather. Those guys can get it all wrong and still keep their jobs. It always frustrates me. These are not predictions that we think maybe will happen or it might happen. No, we know this is truth. This is the Word of God. It predicted that we are going to be attacked, and not just openly. We are so aware, right, of the open attacks that we face. What kind of attacks is this talking about here? Deceit, slipping in to the church. Perhaps things that we even now believe as truth yet are not truth. It's a little scary, right? It ought to be. So the prediction here is fact. While we are here on earth, false teachers will always be here. Mockers, followers of ungodly passions, devoid of the Holy Spirit. And so we see here that in order to be alert, contending for the faith in this world begins with vigilance. So why do these Christians fall to begin with? Lack of alertness, lack of readiness. They weren't vigilant Christians. So what does that look like for us? We should never be going through life under the assumption that things the world offers us as truth are harmless enjoyment, ultimate truth. I think it's unfortunately true that we too often view what we hear as innocent until proven guilty. We're not careful. Imagine a SEAL team having that mindset when dropped into enemy territory. I mean, when they're in enemy territory, what are they doing? They're on alert, without a doubt. They are putting into practice everything they've learned in training. They are not assuming that most everyone they see is friendly unless something happens, right? They're assuming the worst of just about everybody, in a sense, right? Because they're aware. They know what is coming. They know that they are not on friendly soil. They're vigilant. And so the question then is, where do false teachers creep in for us? Well, we can pick out the obvious ones, right? You know, bad friends, bad relationships, the TV, the media, music. You know, we can go through all the obvious ones, right? And those are good. We ought to be aware of those things. We ought to be vigilant against those things. But let's get a little more real. What about your Christian philosophy? Is it possible that the philosophy that you believe right now, how you apply Scripture to your life and everything else, that your whole structure of biblical philosophy, is it just possible that maybe there are falsehoods in that philosophy? That's a little scary to think about, isn't it? But when we think about it, that is wholly likely, right? And what better way for Satan to creep into the church than to creep in with false teaching, with false philosophy of how to live, how to apply Scripture? Do you allow the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit to grow and to change you? Or do you believe the lies of personal bias, tradition, and pride to keep you from growing in the love of Christ? Let me ask that again. Do you allow the lies of personal bias, tradition, and pride to keep you from growing in Christ? Have you allowed your desire for right to obscure the second greatest commandment in Scripture, love thy neighbor as thyself? Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. All right, I want to be careful not to get too much on a soapbox here. But I want us to examine ourselves a little bit. And in this political time that we are in, I'm not going to dwell on the political side too much here at all. But I can't help but just be reminded again and be grieved by some things that I've seen from Christian brothers and sisters in response to the politics of America lately. Well-meaning Christians, I think. Christians that have been saved for years and years. Yeah, I don't think it's a stretch to apply that perhaps there's a wrong philosophy going on in their mind as they approach the field of politics. Let me ask you this. When did the political leaders of the opposing party stop becoming image bearers of God? Now, this is hard. But I want us to be able to just get an example here of perhaps how we sometimes allow false teaching, whether it is by bias, our personal bias, or just traditional things that we brought up, or even our desire so much to do right that we abandon the love of Christ. Some of you, like me, who have been on social media, have seen several posts. Very opinionated posts that are arguing strongly against a certain political figure. To the point where it is really, it's becoming beyond the issue, but actually attacking the person themselves. Very quickly name-calling. Assuming they know the motives of a person. Tell me, brothers and sisters in Christ, where does that fit within love your neighbor, love your enemy? And it's sad to me to see how we can very quickly kind of abandon what we think, what the Bible says about all people. You don't stop being an image bearer of Christ at some point. You are always an image bearer of Christ. All men are image bearers of Christ, and we ought to treat them as such. God doesn't love them any less than he loves you. What gives us a right to treat them that way? To say the things that we say about them? To be so quick to mistreat a people group? To shut them out, to deny them the love of Christ that he so graciously gave to us? Because we have a political agenda that we want so badly to see put through. Do you see, friend, how it's so easy for us as Christians, well-meaning Christians, wanting to fight for right, can easily be deceived by our own selves, by tradition? Remember 1 Corinthians 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not charity, I am become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity valueth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. How does your conversation fit into that passage of certain topics in life? Am I saying that we should not take a stand for righteousness in this world? Absolutely not. We certainly must take a stand. But may I suggest we do so with Ephesians 4, 14 through 15 in mind, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive us. Again, talking about deception and how we should fight against it. Verse 15, but speaking the truth in what? In love. May grow up unto him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. We speak in love that we may grow to be more like Christ. That's just one example. Are you a contender who is alert, who is vigilant? Are you faithfully watching for the enemy, watching for how your flesh and Satan and your pride can creep into your walk with Christ and taint it, destroy it? We must be alert. Number two, we must be mature. Verse 20 and 21 says, but ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Here Jude is urging all believers to take steps. Steps that will open their eyes to the problem of sin, to the problem of false teaching that they have been believing. Steps that will help them to become loyal, steadfast believers, contenders for Christ. Jude is telling us if we are interested in security and success as a believer, then we need to keep moving forward in our spiritual life. Don't go stagnant. To grow in maturity as believers. And he outlines here four steps to help us do this. How do we grow in our maturity? There's a word for this. I tell our teens a lot. It's called sanctification, right? When do you stop growing in your sanctification? Never. Good answer. Never. Not until you get to heaven, right? What are the four things that Jude talks about? Number one, build your faith. Build your faith. You need to become better established in truth, seekers of the promises and teachings of Scripture. It's important that this is the first step. Why? Why is building your faith important? Well, because without faith, what do we really have? It's pointless to go beyond that if the faith isn't founded, right? Faith always precedes action or works. There's a reason that people say pursue after something in life that you are passionate about, that you believe in, that you have faith in. Why? Because in order to find success, you must first have conviction. So grow your faith. Folks, what you believe dictates what you do. So when you say that you want to follow God, yet you never really spend time building your faith in His Word, anticipating something new, or anticipating God to grow you in your sanctification, then you will go nowhere. Growth requires faith. This church that Jude was specifically talking to had a problem of immorality. And while it's easy to see and point to an obvious and blatant sin, people were missing what was really at the root of the problem, and that was immature faith. Let me ask you a question. When you read your Bible, are you looking for God to teach you something new? I mean, if we believe in the process of sanctification, then we have to agree, right, that we must be learning something new then, right? We're not just saying learning the same thing. We're learning something new, or at least new depths of something true, right? You have to be learning in order to grow, correct? Sometimes, I've been saved for a little over 20 years, most of my life. That's a long time, you know, I think 20-some years. Some of you beat me double that easily. You've been saved for 40 years, 50 years. Are you looking for something new? It's easy to think, I know the Bible. I've read the Bible this many times. I know what the Bible says. I know how to apply it. I've been applying it this way for years. What's the problem with that? You're assuming you figured it out way back here and that you no longer need to grow in this certain area. Are you willing and excited about the possibility of learning something new every time you open up the Word of God? Are you asking God, show me something new from your Word today to grow my faith? Are you willing to abandon prideful stands that you've taken on certain issues in the past if they are not in line with the Word of God? That's where it gets hard. I had a discussion with a Christian friend of mine not long ago, and we were having an argument, not an argument, but a discussion, I guess, on a certain issue. And it was an issue that he had held a stand on for years and years and years and years. And it was one that an actual stand that I'd shared at one point. And I'm not saying I'm for sure right in the issue, but I know the Lord has changed my heart on it as I grew. And as I started to study the Word more, and suddenly it dawned on me, nowhere in Scripture does it actually say this. And so I began to question him on it, and he began to pull verses. And then he began to try to argue that this backed up what he believed. The problem was, he was taking a verse out of context. He was applying it in certain ways that it obviously wasn't meant to be applied. He was taking Scripture and pulling it out to kind of fit into the mold of what he felt was right, one that he had learned through tradition and years and years and years of being in the church. That's a scary place to be in. Are you willing to be able to say, God, I'm willing to change as you grow me and teach me in the Word, no matter how long I've held to this, no matter how long I've thought this, is this truth or not? And if it's not, even if it's something that I have made a big stand on before, am I going to be willing to say, teach me, God, grow my faith, grow me in truth, regardless of where or how long I've been a Christian? Be careful of, in pride, saying, I know better than somebody else. I've been a Christian this long. I've studied the Word this long. I've had some humbling times where I've recognized and I've had to say I was wrong in this before. That's not easy. But if we are to believe in the process of sanctification, building our faith, we have to be willing to abandon our pride at times and say, Lord, I'm willing to let this go because I see truth here. I'm willing to put aside my pride and my personal bias on this certain issue because your Word has shown me differently. That's part of how we grow. That's part of our sanctification. We build our faith. Number two, pray in the Holy Spirit. Show me a person who lacks the ability, the power necessary to succeed in the Christian life, and I'll show you a person who probably doesn't value the power of prayer. I speak to myself on that. Why do we pray? Well, we're commanded to, for one thing, right? But beyond that, prayer is what builds our relationship with God, and specifically dealing with what we are talking about today, prayer helps eliminate that creeping self-confidence. Prayer is a humbling action. Because in prayer, you are immediately coming to God, recognizing that He is greater than you. He is in control, not you. And so to properly come before God in prayer, you are saying, God, I am under you. I am your servant. You are the king. You are in control, not me. When do we most likely return to a state of prayer? Well, whenever we feel least in control, right? Praying in the Spirit represents the opposite of doing something in the flesh, in our own strength, in our own power, and that's a great place to be as a believer. That's a great place to be if you're wanting to grow in your faith. The tremendous yet humbling action of prayer. Number three, abiding in Christ's love. Abiding in Christ's love. How do we abide in the love of Christ, and how is that supposed to help us contend for the faith? I've used the example of marriage before with our teens a lot, on what it means to be changed by the love of God. And when you love somebody, you want to serve them, right? Things that you might not normally want to do, you do, and you do it happily because you love that person. We had, a wonderful reminder this weekend with our teens about the love of Christ. The importance of dwelling in that love, being constantly reminded of the gospel day in and day out. Not growing accustomed to it, not growing used to the idea that Christ died on the cross for my sins. I don't want to get used to that idea. I want to be overwhelmed with that idea every day. In order to do that, as I said this morning, we have to be reminding ourselves of our sin, not that we wallow in it, but that we say, yes, I was saved out of my wretchedness because Jesus loved me so much. When we dwell constantly in the love of Christ, we can't help but grow in our love for Him and our love for other people. We'll desire to contend. We'll desire to fight for Him because we are constantly reminding ourselves, yes, Jesus loves me, this I know. Last thing we see here is don't forget the future. Don't forget the future. Jude is saying here, don't forget what you are fighting for. One day, all of this, the world and everything in it, is going to pass away. One day you will no longer have to fight. You will no longer have to suffer. You will no longer have to battle in sin, struggle in sin. One day you will enjoy the mercies of Christ forever in eternity. That's what you're looking forward to. That's what you're fighting for. We fail to contend when we grow too content and happy in this life. Don't forget the future. Don't forget the glory that you fight for, that one day you will be with Christ. And all of this will be gone. This is not worth worrying about. We have everything that we need in Christ, and one day we will be with Him forever. We have a hope that we fight for. So don't forget the future. Have hope. Are you a maturing Christian? Are you a Christian that is constantly moving forward? Are you growing in your faith through the Word of God? Are you putting your trust, your strength in Christ through constant prayer? Are you growing in your love of Christ? Are you remembering the victory to come? This is what contending, this is what fighting for your faith really looks like. And finally, number three, be encouragers. Be encouragers. Verse 22 and 23 says this, "And of some have compassion, making a difference. And others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh." Let me ask you a question. What do we do with those who have fallen? Those who have lost their way. Do we forsake them? Do we condemn them, never to speak, to think of them again? No. We have compassion. We pull them up. We pull them out of the fire. What is the reality about sin? We all do it, right? And who are we to cast a stone? Who are we to pull the splinter out of someone's eye when we have the log sticking out of our own? That's no way we ought to treat believers, right? Fellow believers, fellow Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ. So the question is this church, is the atmosphere in your home, are we as a body of believers defined as a group of people who encourage and strengthen one another in Christ? Can we lift each other up when we fall? Encourage one another in the faith. You know, the beautiful thing about part of the purpose of the church is that we do not have to contend, we do not have to fight alone. We contend for our faith together. And how do we do that? We get involved in each other's lives. By becoming transparent with each other about our fears, our anxieties, our failures, our sins. That one's hard. When's the last time you've been really transparent with a brother or sister in Christ about your sins and your failures? First Thessalonians 5, 11 through 14 says this, "Wherefore comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also ye do. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish them, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but even follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Folks, we do not contend alone. We ought not contend alone. And I want to pause here, and I want us to think about this for just a moment longer. Listen, I grew up in a church where, whether it was preached or not, and I don't think it was necessarily preached, but we had this sense of the more you sinned, or the more open you were about your sin, the more you were a bad Christian. And so you can obviously tell what kind of atmosphere that fostered in that church. No one wanted to be real about their struggles because struggle equaled what? Bad Christian. And that started, and that was from the top down. There was this atmosphere of just like, oh, don't pretend. When you come to church, the less you struggle with life, the less you hurt, the less that you struggle with a certain sin, the better the Christian you are. And so what did it breed? An atmosphere of hypocrisy, right? No longer were we a people that were just upfront and real with each other. I struggle with the same thing you all struggle with. I struggle with pride. I struggle with selfishness. I struggle with anger. I struggle with bitterness at times. I struggle with those things. It's okay to struggle. What are these verses talking about? They're saying when you struggle, you as a body of believers unite together. You encourage one another in Christ. We aren't here to judge one another. And if we have an atmosphere here where it's like, if I go talk to this person, they're going to judge me, so I can't do it. No, that's wrong. The more we respond in humility to one another, say, listen, brother, I am struggling in this area. Will you pray for me? And the right response ought to be, brother, I understand. I do not think any less of you. In fact, I struggle sometimes too with that. Let's keep one another accountable. Let's pray for one another. Let's build one another up in Christ. That's a church. That's what a church looks like. It's time to cast aside the pride and the image that we think of perfection looks like. Our speaker, Brent, he made a great statement on his last message. He said, we were not called to be Christ. Meaning, we weren't called to be perfect. Christ was perfect for us because we could not be. We are called to continue to grow in our sanctification to be like Christ, which means it will be a struggle. It will be hard. We will fail. We will fall. But the struggle is a sign of a growing Christian, right? So let's not hide the struggle with each other. Let's be real about the struggle so that we can encourage one another in Christ. Folks, there are people in this room right now that are discouraged and feel like they don't have anyone to talk to. I can't tell anybody this. They'll judge me. They'll stiff arm me. They'll push me away. Let's be careful to avoid that atmosphere in a church, in our church. Let's love others as Christ loved us. Let's be gracious and merciful to those around us as Christ was gracious and merciful to us. Are we encouraging one another in Christ? And so as I conclude here, I ask you, are you contending? Are you fighting? Are you alert to the dangers of false teaching, both external and the creeping internal dangers? Are your actions, your speech, your love indicative of an ever-maturing follower of Christ? Is your heart and your hope set on the kingdom to come? Are you wallowing in hurt, fears, and disappointments of this fast deteriorating world? Or are you contending for the world to come, the victory to come? Are you contending? Are you fighting for your fellow Christian sitting next to you? Loving, edifying, building up one another in the faith. Why do we fight? Verse 24 and 25. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. We contend because and for the glory of Christ. Would you bow your heads?